The beginning of the 19th century saw pushback against the indulgent ideals of the previous generation. This period gave rise to the American Gothic genre, characterized by the struggle between rational and irrational. This next story, published in 1820, may sound familiar.
Along the banks of the mighty Hudson River, in a region the Dutch navigators called the Tappan Zee, where they would prudently shorten sail and pray for the protection of St. Christopher, there is a quiet little valley known as Sleepy Hollow. Sleepy Hollow is one of those places that time seems to have forgotten. And the people who live there, the descendants of the old Dutch settlers, have carried on for generations in much the same way as their ancestors before them. Furthermore, Sleepy Hollow is one of the quietest places on Earth. So quiet, in fact, that they say the place is bewitched. That in ancient times the Indians held their rituals there. But whatever the cause, the valley is filled with haunted places. And even the people who live there are given over to all sorts of twilight superstitions. Now, chief among the spirits that haunt this valley is the figure of a man on horseback, dressed all in black and riding a great black steed that scours the valley nightly. Now, if you were to encounter this apparition, you would know him immediately, for he is quite conspicuous for his lack of a head. And thus he is known as the Headless Horseman of Sleepy Hollow. Now, the most authentic historians of the region claim that it is the ghost of a Hessian trooper whose head was struck off during some battle during the war. For the British and American lines had run very close to that haunted valley back then. And they say that the body of the trooper is buried in the yard of an old abandoned church in the woods, accessible by an old cart road that crosses a brook by a wooden bridge. And that the spirit of the trooper rises from his grave every night and rides forth into the valley of Sleepy Hollow in nightly quest for his missing head. And his rushing speed, like a midnight blast, is owing no doubt that he must return to his grave by the dawn. At the time of our story, the war had been over for some 20 years. And there dwelt in Sleepy Hollow a young gentleman by the name of Ichabod Crane. He was a native of Connecticut, and being a man of some learning and education, he was called to Sleepy Hollow to serve as schoolteacher. Now, Ichabod Crane was exceedingly tall and lanky. He had hands that dangled what seemed a mile beyond the cuffs of his coat and feet that could serve as a shovel. He had a large, flat head set atop a spindly neck and large, glassy green eyes and a long, snipe nose. Now, to see this figure striding along the crest of a hill with his loose garments fluttering behind him in the breeze, you might be thinking that it was the genius of famine itself descended upon the earth. However, being a man of some learning and accomplishment and culture, his appearance at the tea table was always welcome. And Ichabod Crane spent many a pleasant winter evening by a crackling fire, enjoying the comforts of kitchen and cupboard. For the Dutch wives were known for their hospitality and good cooking. However, the conversations would invariably turn to a favorite topic among the people in Sleepy Hollow: ghosts and strange occurrences. Alas, the witching power of the valley had infected even the well-read mind of Ichabod Crane. And he, in turn, would regale his hosts with excerpts of Cotton Mather's History of New England Witchcraft, in which he most firmly believed. Now, if these evenings were pleasant enough, they were dearly paid for with the long walk home, where perhaps a snow-shrouded bush would appear as a sheeted specter besetting his path, or the crunch of his own footfalls would make him fearful to turn around, lest he see some uncouth being staring back at him. Or perhaps the breeze among the branches would be the Headless Horseman himself. But these were mere terrors of the night, easily dispelled with the dawn, and Ichabod Crane would have had quite an easy time of it had he not encountered a young lady. Katrina Van Tassel was the prettiest young lady in all of Sleepy Hollow, renowned not only for her great beauty, but also for her great expectations. She was the only daughter of the very wealthy Baltus Van Tassel, and the young man who could win her heart would stand to inherit a great estate. Now, such a prize would not come without competition, and so it was that poor Ichabod Crane came into rivalry with a roaring young blade named Abraham Van Brunt, or Brom in the local abbreviation. And if Ichabod was exceedingly tall and lank, Brom was known for his great strength and large, powerful frame, and thus he had gained the name of Brom Bones. However, perhaps owing to Ichabod's superior culture, he seemed to be gaining the upper hand. And as Ichabod's suit gained, Brom's seemed to wane, and his horse was seldom more seen at the palings of the Van Tassel mansion. However, Brom was a jealous man. And so things stood for quite some time, when one fine autumnal day, while Ichabod sat in his schoolhouse while his children were conning over their lessons, a servant of the Van Tassels came up and delivered a message. That night, there was to be a quilting frolic at the Van Tassel mansion. Well, whereas everything was all quiet, now everything was all bustle and activity, and Ichabod hurried his students through his lessons and sent them home an hour early. Then he rushed back to his lodgings at the Van Ripper farm. He adjusted his looks in the mirror and donned his best, only suit of rusty black. And he borrowed a broken-down old farm horse and Hans Van Ripper's best saddle. And thus mounted, like a knight-errant off to rescue his fair damsel, he made his way to the estate of the Van Tassels. When he arrived, the scene that was set before him was dazzling. And there was a table set with every kind of delicacy of the Dutch kitchen. Now, I do not have time to describe the scene properly to you, but rest assured, Ichabod Crane sampled each and every dish. And then after dinner, the tuning of a fiddle signaled the time for dancing. And there was Ichabod Crane, turning and bowing and promenading with the lady of his heart. All the while, Brom sat by looking on in sullen silence. Well, soon as the evening progressed, the people settled down by the crackling fire, and the old men were there sharing stories. But the conversation was anything but comforting. Apparently, the headless horseman had been seen in the valley of late. Now, one old farmer by the name of Brower said that he got up behind the headless horseman just two nights ago, and he chased him over hill and dale, but when they came down the old road to the abandoned church, where the body of the trooper was supposed to be buried, as soon as he came to the bridge that crossed the brook, the headless horseman turned into a skeleton and threw old Brower into the brook and then disappeared in a flash of fire and brimstone. Now, Brom Bones was rather unimpressed, and he said he encountered the horseman the other night and dismissed him as an errant jockey. Said he challenged him to a race and a bowl of punch. And, said he, I should have won it too, for my horse Daredevil could not be beat by any horse, alive or dead. But, like in Brower's story, when he came to the bridge over the brook, the horseman simply disappeared. Eventually, the evening came to an end, and everybody made their way back to their homes, and their carts could be heard rattling among the hills amidst mingled laughter. Ichabod and Katrina were left alone. And after the custom of the time, Ichabod hoped that night to perhaps seal his victory and ask for Katrina's hand in marriage. I do not pretend to know what happened between them. Was perhaps Katrina playing him off and trying to make Brom jealous? We'll never know. But I fear something went terribly wrong, for after a very short time, Ichabod came out of the house and made his way straight to the stable, where he roused poor Gunpowder with many an uncourtesy kick and cuff. And then he made his way down through Sleepy Hollow, back to the Van Ripper house. It was the very hour of midnight. And the moon was veiled by the clouds. And there was a slight breeze that made the branches sway and groan. Soon, the thoughts of ghosts and the conversations that had been happening drowned out the memory of his recent heartache. For his road was beset with perils of the invisible world. For not far beyond the Van Tassel mansion, there was a great tulip tree whose boughs reached down nearly to the ground, and it had an evil reputation, for it was upon that tree during the war that Tories and traitors were hanged. And then further beyond that, as he walked with gunpowder, the road crossed a small brook, likewise of evil reputation, for it was at that very tree-shaded spot that the unfortunate British officer, Major Andre, had been captured and later executed. And unhappy was the traveler who had to pass that brook after dark. Thinking to put this peril behind him, Ichabod applied a heel and crop to gunpowder to quicken his pace. And as they approached the spot where Major Andre was captured, the perverse old animal stopped dead in his tracks. Ichabod again kicked him and applied the crop, but the animal darted right and then left, but he would not cross the brook. Now, this argument went on for seemingly hours. Ichabod's fear was turning into panic. But then, in the shadows at the side of the road, he heard the distinctive sound of a horse's tramp. Ichabod stopped. He looked. It was so dark he could not see, just perhaps a darker bulk in the moonlight. Who's there? He cried. There was no answer. Who are you? Again, no reply. And there was something appalling in the silence, which Ichabod could not quite account for. He again turned his attention to gunpowder and kicked him and hit him with his crop. And gunpowder seemingly got over his waywardness and crossed the brook. But as they crossed, Ichabod heard the distinctive plashy tramping of a horse as his midnight companion also crossed the brook. Ichabod was being followed. So Ichabod thought, well, perhaps I'll sing an old psalm tune and put my mind at ease, but his voice caught in his throat as his mouth was too dry to make a sound. And then he thought he could perhaps leave this companion behind, and so he quickened his pace. But so did the follower. And then he thought, well, perhaps I can pull off to the side and stop, and whoever it is will pass me by. And so nervously, he reined gunpowder to a halt. But so did the other. Just at that moment, a slight breeze stirred the clouds, and it freed the moon and the stars, and they shone down upon the road, and Ichabod looked behind him, and he saw who was following him. He was a man with a large, powerful frame on a large black horse, and yet he could see in the moonlight that the silhouette ended abruptly at the shoulders. It was the headless horseman! So Ichabod applied spur to gunpowder and they dashed off down the road, but the horseman was full jump with them. As they dashed along, and he could almost feel the goblin horse's hot breath on his very neck. And in his panicked flight, he hardly noticed that his saddle had begun to slip, and that eventually it fell off and crashed to the ground and was trampled by his pursuer. Ichabod hanged on to gunpowder with all his might. And then they came down to a place where the road forked. To the left, the road led to the village and safety, but to the right was the old cart road that led to the abandoned church. Frantically, Ichabod reined and spurred gunpowder to the left, but the animal darted to the right down the old cart road, and the horseman still behind him. But not all hope was lost, for Ichabod realized that if he could just make the old bridge across the brook, the The horseman, according to the rules, would disappear, and he would be safe. So he applied his heels to gunpowder for one last burst of speed, and then presently he was upon the bridge, clattering over the planks. And when he gained the opposite side, he stopped, and he looked behind him to see if the ghost had disappeared. He had not. To his horror, he realized that the horseman had raised himself up to his full height, well, almost his full height, and held before him his head. And he hurled the horrible missile straight at Ichabod, and it collided with Ichabod's head with a horrible thud. And Ichabod went down into the ground, and Gunpowder and the Headless Horseman galloped off into the night. The next morning, Gunpowder was seen munching grass back at the Van Ripper farm without his saddle and without his rider. A search was made throughout Sleepy Hollow, but Ichabod was never found. Down at the brook, they discovered Ichabod's hat, and about it, smashed bits of pumpkin. But no sign of Ichabod Crane, and he was never seen in Sleepy Hollow again. Now, years after, some claim that Ichabod was so frightened that night that he ran all the way back to Connecticut. And whenever the story was told in Sleepy Hollow of Ichabod Crane and the Headless Horseman, Brom Bones would have a peculiar gleam in his eye, and by his laughter it seemed that he knew more than he was letting on. But there were some who firmly believed that he was in fact spirited away by the Headless Horseman and taken back into his grave by the old abandoned church across the brook. Of course, that is the story that some people believe. I, however, don't believe a word of it.